We're reading from one of the greatest novels ever written. Check out what the library uses. They still use these cards. But 1984, and if you come from a dumped upon community in any way, you've always lived under this, but everybody's understanding that we're in a 1984 moment. Winston had never been able to feel sure. Even after this morning's flash of the eyes, it was still impossible to be sure whether O'Brien was a friend or an enemy. Nor did it even seem to matter greatly. There was a link of understanding between them more important than affection or partisanship. "We shall meet in the place where there is no darkness," he had said. Winston did not know what it meant, only that it, in some way or another, it would come true. The voice from the telescreen paused. A trumpet call, clear and beautiful, floated into the stagnant air. The voice continued raspingly. "Attention. Your attention, please. A news flash has this moment arrived from the Malabar front. Our forces in South India have won a glorious victory. I'm authorized to say that the action we are now reporting may well bring the war within measurable distance of its end. Here is the news flash. Bad news coming," thought Winston, and sure enough, following a gory description of annihilation of a Eurasian army with stupendous figures of killed and prisoners, came the announcement that as from next week, the chocolate ration would be reduced from 30 grams to 20. Winston belched again. The gin was wearing off, leaving a deflated feeling. The telescreen, perhaps to celebrate the victory, perhaps to drown the memory of the lost chocolate, crashed into Oceania. "'Tis for thee. You were supposed to stand at attention." However, in this present position, he was invisible. Oceania, 'tis for thee, gave way to lighter music. Winston walked over to the window, keeping his back to the telescreen. The day was still cold and clear. Somewhere far away, a rocket bomb exploded with a dull, reverberating roar. About 20 or 30 of them a week were falling on London at present. Down in the street, the wind flapped the torn poster to and fro, and the word Ingsoc fitfully appeared and vanished. Ingsoc, the sacred principles of Ingsoc, Newspeak, Doublethink, the mutability of the past. He felt as though he were wandering in the forests of the sea bottom, lost in a monstrous world where he himself was the monster. He was alone. The past was dead. The future was unimaginable. What certainty had he that a single human creature now living was on his side? And what way of knowing that the dominion of the party would not endure forever? Like an answer, three slogans on the white face of the military of truth, I'm sorry, the Ministry of Truth, came back at him. War is peace, freedom is slavery, ignorance is strength. He took a 25-cent piece out of his pocket. There too, in tiny clear lettering, the same slogans were inscribed, and on the other face of the coin, the head of Big Brother. "Even from the coin, the eyes pursued you. On coins, on stamps, and on covers of books, on banners, on posters, and on the wrapping of a cigarette pack. Everywhere. Always the eyes watching you, and the voice enveloping you, asleep or awake, working or eating, indoors or out of doors, in the bath or in the bed. No escape. Nothing was your own except a few cubic centimeters inside your skull." The sun had shifted round, and the myriad of windows of the Ministry of Truth, with the light no longer shining on them, looked grim as the loopholes of a fortress. His heart quailed before the enormous pyramidal shape. It was too strong. It could not be stormed. 1,000 rocket bombs would not batter it down. He wondered again for whom he was writing the diary. For the future? For the past? For an age that might be imaginary? And in front of him, there lay not death, but annihilation. The diary would be reduced to ashes and himself to vapor. Only the door police would read and what he had written before they wiped it out of existence and out of memory. How could you make appeal to the future when not a trace of you, not even an anonymous word scribbled on a piece of paper, could physically survive? I mean, we have the internet, so we have a lot of words and work that's out there. We have a lot of video that's out there, a lot of podcasts that are out there. And as long as there's somebody maintaining these systems, our work will survive. I guess I should really print some of my books out just to have paper copies. I don't know. But when there's no sense that none of your work is going to survive, then there's almost no point in doing it. Especially someone like me whose work is not really appreciated until much later. So that's a very important issue, something that the internet has changed. When I first read this, I was going to the print shop making books. And it was a hard process. And then they'd end up in my house. But with the internet, my stuff goes around the world and accessible to more eyes. I also like this passage because he's saying, this tyranny may never end. And a lot of people are talking about getting rid of Donald Trump so we can go back to some quote unquote normal. But we were under tyranny before him. That's how he came to power. And when he leaves, that tyranny is going to be there on the state level, on the local level, and the federal level. So we have to be careful as we're out in the street protesting, as we're creating, as we're doing all these things. We need to build a society that's anti-tyrannical, if that's a phrase. And that's the goal. And then work on it every day. Because you can't ever relax or get satisfied. So this book, great, teaches you so much. And until next time, I want to say thank you for your support. Take care of your mind, take care of your body, and be safe.